And we just kind of accidentally left the video camera on.
We sure did. Actually, we did. No.
No.
So this is how it is. I had it set up with Mr. and Mrs. Claus and with complete instructions. And they already knew our children, right? So and they also knew how to stack the presents. So I text them. Well, that's not true. I had a preset. This is way back in the day where I call up my
paging service.
Yeah. And I already had to send this page. And then I called up the paging service while the boys were upstairs, and they delayed the page for 10 minutes. So 10 minutes later, the page hits, and Mr. and Mrs. Claus show up at our home.
While we're gone.
They have the access to our home. They go and turn on the video camera, or Mrs. Claus did, as Mr. Claus had stuck himself in the chimney.
Mm-hmm.
And when the video camera started, it was Mr. Claus coming out of the chimney, backing out.
With
a big bag of toys, going, oh my gosh, we're at the Himmers. Yeah, I can't wait to see the face of Charles and Andrew and Stuart and Scott. So he names all of our boys. And then Mrs. Claus kind of just comes in from the side.
They're like, how did Mrs. Claus get there? The kids never asked that. But anyways, the videotape, you know, showed them doing their deed. They were filling the stockings and putting presents around the tree. So we get back from doing the Secret Santa. The boys come in and they see everything laid out just as if all the previous years.
Right.
And then they enjoy Christmas. And then we say, oh my goodness, guys, the video camera's been on the whole time. And we replay this video. And
Mr. and Mrs. Claus are talking about our children like they know them on a first name basis.
Our kids grew up with this 1 year of, we have proof. We have proof that Santa comes out of the chimney.
Right.
And our third born was young enough that carried well beyond where fantasy and reality usually sort themselves out.
Yeah.
And so,
well, there's a psychological reason why. It's the way the brain is wired.
Right. But that he wasn't the baby, but he was
he had to be about
5 or 6.
Okay.
And so his 7 years old is when fantasy and reality starts to get sorted. And it was pre that time for him. And so he held on to it longer than most kids.
From a scientific standpoint, what happened was his critical faculty was bypassed, that there does exist a Santa. He's got proof there exists a Santa. And anything anyone else says would violate what he already knows, that's been imprinted upon his subconscious. It's not that he was a gullible child.
No.
But if you were taught that a square is really a triangle as a kid, you're going to believe that until...
So it's really upon us that we over-impressed the idea of Santa to our son. And it may have caused him to be ridiculed older.
It did.
And so I take that fault. You've got to take it too, because we schemed this together.
Absolutely.
But I would have to say it is a joyous memory for us as parents. Is that okay? I don't know. Anyways, we'll leave that question out there if we harmed our child or not.
We're really not interested in whether we were right or wrong. It was really fun. We learned from it. We understand psychology and the neuroscience behind it today. We didn't understand it then.
Right. But Santa is often demonized and ridiculed, despite the fact that some people think you shouldn't even tell children about it at all. But can Santa be more than that?
So here's the 16 points about Santa and Christ.
16.
Santa,
there's validity to him.
Santa dresses in red. That represents the atonement. And white. That's purity. When Christ comes again, he'll be dressed in red. So here's the story behind it. When Christ was in the garden of Gethsemane, he bled internally, bled from every pore. His internal garment was red. When he comes again, his external garment will be red, according to the way we understand it. He's coming to atone for our sins. And those people who accept Jesus Christ are going to have their sins covered. That's what the whole atonement is about. Santa is a representation of that. Number two, the hair of his head was white like pure snow. Number three, he ascends into and descends from heaven. And by the way, I have a scriptural reference for all of these things.
Yeah, so just think of Santa coming down the chimney. It is a symbolic representation of the Savior's transport. Number four, his sleigh is pulled by flying reindeer. Well, Elijah, who also is a type of Christ, was taken into heaven by a chariot of fire and horses of fire. Now, Do those symbols just, like, can you imagine that and visually connect with that? The chariot throne of God is pulled by cherubim, depicted as animals with wings, symbolizing the ability to move quickly on earth and in heaven. And we know Santa is quick.
Yeah, that is beautiful.
So we love this. We love to have fun with the symbol of Santa.
Okay, number five, he comes as a thief in the night, who enters not by the door.
Same as.
Now, here's the other thing. The actual, and we're going to do this in, I think, the next segment. We're going to talk a little bit about the parable that is associated with this. But the reality is nobody knows when Christ is coming again. You don't exactly know when Santa's going to come during the night, right? Although I do remember in the 60s, we used to tune into a radio program that would tell us where Santa was. He's right now coming over Pennsylvania. I remember this.
We're not the only ones.
Number six.
Propagated Santa.
He is happy, loving, and giving.
He invites little children to come unto him.
Number eight. Little children believe in him and most actually believe him, which is another whole discussion. There's a difference between believing in him and actually believing him.
Number nine, we are invited to become as little children.
Number 10, he knows if you've been bad or good.
Number 11, he rewards every person according to their works.
Number 12, gifts are personal and anonymous.
Number 13, we ask for gifts and blessings. We write letters to Santa.
We do. And number 14, we don't get everything we ask for, except on December 24th. Now, I was just doing some writing for a course that we're doing. And what I wrote in there was, oftentimes, I've heard it said, if God really wanted to punish his children, he actually would give them everything they ask for. But we don't get everything we ask for. It's not always the best thing. Okay.
We get what we need. Number 15, Santa gives children unearned gifts that they cannot get without him. And Christ offers us the unearned gifts of immortality and eternal life that we can't attain without him.
Now, you just got both works and grace in the whole Santa
symbol.
And number 16, we're not always grateful for the gifts we receive.
Well, I hope we can be. And so I hope we can be grateful about Santa, too, and see it in a different way. And maybe if it feels offensive, we can get past that.
Yeah. So what we want to do is give you the four stages of Santa. And then we're going to end this segment and start the trivia question coming in for the next one. So the four stages of Santa. Number one, you believe in Santa.
Mm-hmm. And then you don't believe in Santa.
Second stage. Number three, you are Santa.
And we had a little too much fun with that.
And if you could just see these pictures, you'd love them.
Yep.
Number four, you look like Santa.
You get a little rounder, get a little white-haired.
CHERI and I have a really dear friend. He's a professor at a Midwestern university. And he was able to get a part in The Chosen.
Oh, I highly recommend downloading the Chosen app if you like to follow the New Testament and the life of the Savior.
It's beautifully done. But he got a role as a Pharisee because he has white hair and a white beard, and he's a very tall man. And so I call him my favorite Pharisee. But he literally, he says,
Has he got a Santa beard going?
Oh, my gosh. And it's really long. It's really looking good. And he keeps going. I mean, he's going to be the quintessential Santa.
Oh, he'll get a job at Macy's for sure.
Okay, so let's summarize what we got today and prepare for the trivia question coming up in the next segment.
So I love this exercise of Christmas because isn't it fun to think of things differently than the way you did before? Isn't it fun to just break your own thought traditions? And it doesn't necessarily you break your practice traditions, but to think about your traditions in a way more deeply and have fun with symbols, because Christmas is full of symbols, and hopefully we can see how they do symbolize and remind us of Christ.
And my takeaway, and it happens every time I do this, was the Xmas. It's such a dramatic paradigm to go from thinking that you're removing Christ to actually you're putting him in. When you put the X It's the actual Greek representation symbol for Jesus Christ. So again, Merry Christmas to all of you, and we look forward to having a little trivia with you in the next segment.
Turn it down, but I can't quite drown it out. I'm tortured every day.